McCullough-Pitts neuron model. Artificial neural networks essentially tries to mimic the real behavior of biological neural networks. So the first ever primitive model has been conceptualized by Warren Sturgis McCullough and Walter Harry Pitts in the year 1943. So these scientists came from the neuropsychology and computational neuroscience backgrounds. So basing upon their names, this neuronal model has been named McCullough-Pitts neuron model. Let us now see the different parts of McCullough-Pitts neuron model. There are basically four different types of parts. The first one is neuron, the second one is excitatory input, the third one is inhibitory input, and the fourth one is output. Let us now see about each and every part in detail. The first component is neuron. A neuron is a computational unit which is going to have the incoming input signals. We shall see the diagrammatic representation shortly. So these input signals are computed, and basing upon these input signals, an output is fired. So further, the neurons consist of the following two elements. The first one is summation function, and the second one is activation function. The summation function calculates the sum of the incoming inputs, where these inputs are called excitatory inputs. The activation function is nothing but a step function which sees if whether this particular summation function is greater than or equal to a preset threshold value. That is, in this neuron model, we will be setting the threshold value prior to the execution. So now we will see whether this particular output of the summation function, if it is greater than or equal to a predefined threshold value, then basing upon this, the output depends. That is, if the summation value is greater than or equal to a threshold value, it means if it is yes, then the neuron should fire, then the output will be 1. If the summation function is not greater than or equal to, that is, if the summation function is less than the threshold value, then the neuron should not fire. That is, the output is equal to 0. So, generalizing that, if the summation value is greater than or equal to threshold value, then the neuron fires and the output will be 1. If the summation value is less than the threshold value, then the neuron does not fire and the output is equal to 0. Now, the second component is excitatory input. So, this input is an incoming binary signal to the neuron, where this signal can have only two values, that is either 0 or 1. So, the value 0 indicates that the input is not present, that is the input is off, whereas the value 1 indicates that the input is present or the input is on. The third type of component is inhibitory input. So, this type of input is another type of input signal to the neuron. We shall see what is inhibitory input shortly. So, if this inhibitory input is on, then this input will not allow the neuron to fire, even though the excitatory input of this particular neuron are on. That is, if excitatory inputs are on, but if the inhibitory input is also on, then the neuron will not be allowed to fire. The last component is output. So, this is simply the output of a neuron, which again can take only binary values, that is 0 or 1. So, the value of 0 indicates that the neuron did not fire, and the value 1 indicates that the neuron has fired. So, to better understand the working of McCullough-Pitts model, we shall see the diagrammatical representation. So, if you see here, the input signals are switched on and the neuron is activated. So, this X1 and X2 are input signals, and this I is inhibitory input. If you see here, X1 and X2 are excitatory inputs, I is inhibitory input, and theta is threshold value. Let us consider the case 1, where in this case 1, the X1 input is on and X2 input is also on. So, this is X1 input and this is X2 input. The inhibitory input is off, and now we have decided a threshold value theta is equal to 1. So, now whenever we are going to sum up all the total number of excitatory inputs here, that is X1 and X2. So, So we have x1 as on and x2 as on. So let us think that x1 is 1 and x2 is 1. So 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. So now this value, this output value will now be checked with the threshold value. What is our decided threshold value? The theta is equal to 1. So now is 2 greater than or equal to the threshold value? Is 2 is greater than or equal to 1? Yes. So here we are checking whether if the sum is greater than or equal to the threshold value theta. Yes, 2 is greater than or equal to 1. So the neuron will be fired and finally the output is 1. So this is how a Maculopitz neuron model is going to work. Let us now see the another example. So here if there is no inhibitory input, that is if the inhibitory input is absent, then the neuron proceeds to calculate the sum of the number of excitatory inputs that are switched on. So here x1 is on and x2 is in off state. So also inhibitory input is also off state. So here we have decided the threshold value as 2. So now we are going to find out the sum of the total number of excitatory inputs. So here we are going to find out, or we are summing up the number of excitatory inputs. Here only one excitatory input is in the on state, that is only x1. So we consider only x1 because x2 is in the off state. So finally the x1 value is equal to 1. Now we will check this particular value with the threshold value. What is the threshold value? Theta is equal to 2. So now if you see here, we will check this sum. So what is our sum here? We have 1. So check whether this sum is greater than or equal to the threshold value theta. So what is the threshold value? 2. So is 1 greater than or equal to 2? No. So now the neuron does not fire. So which means the output of this particular neuron is 0, because the neuron has not fired, the output will be 0. Let us consider the another case. So the third case is if the neuron detects that inhibitory input is switched on, the output is straight away it is 0, which means the neuron does not fire. So if you observe here, the excitatory inputs x1 and x2 are on, but along with the inhibitory input I is also on. So if the inhibitory input I is on, now that neuron does not consider, or the neuron does not see the excitatory inputs, that is x1 and x2, because inhibitory input is on, simply the neuron will not fire. That is, even though the x1 and x2 inputs here, the x1 and x2 inputs are set to on state, but the inhibitory input is also set to on. So that is the reason the neuron does not fire, and the output of the neuron will be now equal to 0, stating that the neuron is not going to fire. So these are all the different cases of examples of how a Maculopitz neuron is going to work.